very much, Jean. Next, I'd like to introduce our second speaker, Dr. Margaret Kahn, who's Chief Medical Scientist at Centrium, which is a company that creates predictive analytic systems integrating home monitoring with longitudinal health data for patients with complex chronic diseases. What Centrium does is identify patients who are likely to need hospitalization days before it actually becomes, they actually become seriously ill, and that provides time to intervene and avoid hospitalization, hopefully. Prior to that position, he was Chief Medical Scientist for Care Delivery Systems in IBM Research, where he developed analytic tools for healthcare, including the use of the Watson supercomputer. He's board certified in emergency medicine and clinical informatics and has training in electrical engineering and health management and policy. He speaks frequently on the role of big data in clinical decision support and the transformation of healthcare. So today we have the privilege of him listening to a talk entitled Guidelines, Personalized Healthcare and Real World Data.
Can you hear me now? That better? Okay. One of the models of our company is artificial intelligence. AI is easy. AI is tough. So by way of disclosure, as mentioned, I am an employee of a stockholder in the Centrium, which does big data and predictive analytics for patients with chronic disease. And that will be relevant to the subject I'm going to talk about today. By way of full disclosure, I am highly intimidated, so be prepared for that. So if we're going to address the issue of whether we need to include other forms of evidence and guidelines, then I want to talk a little bit about the evolution of evidence as we've experienced it over the years. The dominant form has been for a very long time. The gold standard for evidence has been the randomized controlled study. I would argue that they're going to be far less important going forward than they have been in the past for a variety of reasons. They have numerous limitations. The traditional randomized controlled study is inherently short-term. You know, other than very unusual studies like the Framingham studies, you cannot do them over very long periods of time. So things that may happen late that would change your conclusions are not evident. You can't handle your approach. It's a somewhat artificial environment. It's a controlled study. It's a controlled environment. It doesn't really represent the real world. And they're essentially population comparisons, not individual focus. They're disease focused and population comparisons. So you have group A and group B. Group A gets one treatment, group B gets a different treatment or no treatment. You compare them and say, on average, group A did better than group B. And use that as a conclusion. So for the 50 years that I've been working in healthcare, that was the standard. And if the controlled study showed that this drug worked for this problem, you gave that to the patient. But then you dealt with the fact that 30-40% of the time it wasn't helpful. And that's because that was a population comparison. And undoubtedly in the group A that did better, there were some patients that did worse. And in the group B that on average did worse, there were some patients that did better. But it's very hard to get that individual information out of those kinds of studies. So when you're making a decision for an individual patient, they're not all that useful. The additional kind of side effects are that they're very expensive studies. They're very demanding on the researchers. And the NIH published a report a few years ago that suggested that it's so difficult to do a good randomized controlled study that 85% of physicians who do it only once and then do it again. So it has certain limitations that make it less than ideally useful for the era where now we're pushing towards personalized and individualized medicine. So even if the studies were done really well, they have distinct limitations. But more and more now we're getting concerned about the quality of those studies themselves. So recently, Marshall Engel, who was the most recent was the editor-in-chief of the New England Journal of Medicine, has said it's no longer possible to believe a lot of clinical research. Richard Horton, who's the current editor-in-chief of Lancet, says a lot of what is published is simply incorrect. John Muir is a physician at Stanford University, has been studying the integrity of published research, and he's concluded that much of what is published is simply misleading, exaggerated, or flat out wrong, and increasing concern that a lot of it is false findings. Other studies show that roughly 60% of published studies cannot be repeated. So our gold standard for research and evidence is not really all that gold. It's quite tarnished. And in the pharmaceutical industry, I was giving a similar talk to some of the CEOs of some of the big pharma, and they argued that that's not true for the pharmaceutical industry. Their research is perfect. It turns out it's not, and in fact, one study showed that only 20 to 25% of the time when they publish their research, did they use their actual data. So we have a problem here. Our gold standard for evidence isn't as useful as we want it to be. So it's gotten to the point where there's an article in the journal Nature about 4 or 5 months ago that was concerned about how much researchers manipulate their data. And they collect their data, and they select data that is most useful to support their goal. And they choose, they go through numerous analytic processes to come up with the one analytic process that will validate their supposition and use it. So now there's a recommendation going beyond double blinding to triple blinding. And in triple blinding, you either have a researcher who is unaware of any of what's going on, just has the numbers, or I do a computer program that takes the original data and generates numerous variations on that data. And then the analysts take all these different data sets, choose one analytic method without knowing what is the real data, and only after they have done all their analyses are they told what the real data is so they can't fudge the results. So we've got a real problem in what we have considered the gold standard. And in context now, we have all sorts of problems in healthcare, waste of undesirable outcomes. One of the strategies for addressing that is personalized healthcare, being able to focus and make decisions that are more likely to be beneficial for the individual patient. And these population kinds of studies that are the critical ones don't help us very much there. Now, the idea of individualized medicine is not brand new, despite the claims of the genomics industry that they have invented it. It's been around for a long time. The first article I ever read about personalized medicine was July 4th, 1968. That was the goal of describing this article, was to learn enough about the individual patient that we could make decisions more appropriate for that individual. The problem back then is we didn't have the ability to do that. We couldn't collect that kind of data, we couldn't analyze that kind of data, so it was a dream. But now we can. Now we have the ability to actually learn about patients individually and where they live in the real world. So this is where things like telemedicine, remote patient monitoring, wearables come in. They will be an essential part of evidence for the future. Because if we're going to make decisions about individuals, well, what would it be in the real world? What is it like for a patient who has congestive heart failure and COPD living in the Los Angeles basement every day? And how can I learn enough about that patient's life and that patient's course of disease that I can make that patient's life better? I'm not going to do it from randomized controlled studies. One of the other limitations on the RCTs is they're disease focused. You will not see very many, if any, randomized controlled studies on patients with multiple comorbidities. But for most older patients with chronic disease, that's exactly what they have. So you will never see, for example, an article about managing patients with coronary artery disease and asthma. The optimal management for those two diseases are antithetical. That which you would give to make asthma better will make symptoms of coronary artery disease worse, and vice versa. There'll never be a controlled study about that. The only way we're going to be able to learn how to optimize the management of such patients is to get data in the real world about thousands and thousands of these patients and find out who did better and why. So this is data that can be collected. It's not very expensive to do it, and it's real world. It helps us make decisions about those individuals where they really live. So this gets us into the area of big data. Big data has several characteristics. One, if there's a lot of data, it comes at you very fast, but it also has uncertainty. If you're collecting data from the real world, a lot of the data you collect may be inaccurate, it may be redundant, it may be simply poorly reported, and you have to be able to deal with that. But one of the things it can do for you that the randomized controlled study can't do is come up with ideas that you haven't thought of. A premise of a randomized controlled study is the null hypothesis. You come up with an idea that you want to test. And ideally, you should have just one or as few as possible, because if you get too many hypotheses randomly, you're going to get one that seems to be statistically significant. But you have to come up with the idea first. If there is something out there that would be beneficial for a patient that you haven't thought of, the traditional study will not find it. And using big data and collecting real-world data in large amounts, and studying it, you come up with the non-hypothesis testing. And you look for associations in all this data. And some of those associations may be flawed and just statistically randomly appear to be important. But then it gives you something to study, and it's the opportunity to learn something you never thought about that might be helpful. And so this is an example of the uncertainty when we're dealing with big data and why it's difficult to convert it into evidence. And so the opportunity it provides also is a great challenge. This was a study from IBM in 2012 on the amount of uncertainty in healthcare data. The estimate is that 80% of the data you get from the real world in healthcare is uncertain, which means you have to use probabilistic evaluations and systems to deal with that data, assess your outcomes, and find out if this data were different, would it change my outcome? It makes it much more difficult, but it gives you the opportunity to be in the real world that you wouldn't have had before. And this is not an isolated idea. This was an article just this year in the International Medical Informatics Association yearbook. We will have massive amounts of data. And the reality is that the very nature of knowledge, reasoning, and decision-making is changing under our feet. It's going on right now, and we need to catch up to it. This only makes sense then because of all the limitations of it and the challenges of it and the idea of non-hypothesis testing and is what we're learning going to be useful at all, is it has to fit in what's called the rapid learning health system. You do your interim analysis, you get your data, you make your prediction, your conjecture, and then you try it out. And then you track the results, and you feed it back into the system in a constant process of learning healthcare. This was, there's the center, at the University of Michigan, there's the Center for Learning Healthcare, where they're developing all these methodologies to use this feedback, it's called machine learning, to improve everything. You make a hypothesis, you find out it's accurate, that feeds back. You make a hypothesis, you find out it's flawed, that feeds back. And over time, your ability to correctly predict, identify, come up with the right diagnosis or the right therapy improves. And it's the only way, from my perspective, and as I warned you before, I'm highly opinionated, it's the only way, from my perspective, that we will actually be able to move towards making good decisions for the individual patient. One of the demonstrations of the limitation of what our population analytics shows us is some of the treatments that are used quite frequently. For instance, the drug Lipitor. Okay, a measure of the precision of prescribing the drug is something called the number needed to treat. How many patients do you have to treat for how long for one patient to get benefit? The estimate for Lipitor is that at least 100, perhaps more than 250 people have to be treated with Lipitor for 5 years before one patient will see benefit. That's the result of the population study. Wouldn't it be better for us if we could be more precise and say these are the 10% of patients that actually ought to get the Lipitor and the others will not get benefit from it? We can't do that with randomized controlled studies. We can't do that with real-world study. Another example of real-world study is the problem with Vioxx causing increased cardiac disease. was a real-world study done by Kaiser Permanente in California with its millions of patients. It was not discovered in the clinical trials prior to it actually being out in the real world. And even covered in today's New England Journal, the algorithms of machine learning, which consider vast numbers of variables looking for combinations every year, reliably predict outcomes will improve prognosis, improve diagnostic accuracy. One of the authors is Zeke Emanuel here at the University of Pennsylvania. So this is the real world now. It is changing, and we need to catch up with it. If you think my ideas are a little controversial, I welcome your challenge, but I always take some comfort in this quotation from Albert Einstein. And I thank you.